Good evening. It's a great pleasure to welcome you tonight to our lecture series, The United States and World Affairs, the Cold War and Beyond. I'm Klaus Laris, and I'm the Richard M. Krasno Distinguished Professor of History and International Affairs here at the University of North Carolina in sunny Chapel Hill. Thank you very much for coming in such large numbers tonight. I think we have to move our room once again. We should go to the Mandela Auditorium
in the future.
So thank you very much for coming. I would like to welcome Professor Jeffrey Herf of the University of Maryland, who is our speaker tonight. And as always, I would like to point out our YouTube channel to you. I'm sure you are watching it regularly anyway, but for those few of you who are not watching our YouTube channel, please don't forget to do so. All our talks and lectures, both in our lecture series United States and World Affairs and in our Ambassadors Forum, all these talks can be seen on our YouTube channel. And the address is youtube.com/Krasno UNC. I'm sorry. Before we continue with this evening, I would like to say something about this series. As you know, the series has been running for the last 3 years, since the fall of 2012. We have had many eminent and senior scholars from all over the country, and sometimes also from abroad. And and this semester is particularly full. We have a large number of lectures. We have, in the future, we will have one on Iran and the nuclear deal in two weeks' time. We will have one on the Nixon administration and nuclear policy of the Nixon administration. There will be a roundtable on German-American relations and also the showing of a film, together with a man and producer and author from German television who is coming to talk to us, and many other things. Next spring, I luckily will be on research leave, so there will probably not be any lectures. Then I would like to start again in the fall of 2016. However, we have a little bit of a problem because we had a meeting recently and I was told we are running out of money. So I will still try to, you know, get lectures together and to make sure that I find money from roundabout UNC somewhere, from all sorts of outlets. The Dean's Office, UNC Global, the History Department, PWAD, many other outlets. But I was also told that it would be good to find a private donor, or several private donors. So if you know someone who is highly interested in international affairs and American foreign policy, and who would also like to spend a few dollars on us, so to speak, then please point out this lecture series to this person and ask this person, or these persons, you know, plural is fine, as many as possible, to come and contact me. And it really is a serious situation. We are running out of money, so a private donor would be, or several private donors, would be very helpful indeed. Since its creation in May 1948, the State of Israel often has been at the center of world attention. Frequently, Israel has been the victim of many threats and much violence against it. And often Israel itself has resorted to violence, and frequently it has been a nation on the warpath. The relations of the Western world with the State of Israel, in principle, have been very positive and supportive. But at times they have been fraught with tension and animosities. The current relationship, for example, between President Obama and Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu is perhaps not the best one, arguably. For obvious reasons, Germany's relationship with Israel since World War II has been a very complex one. In the world at large, Germany is probably one of the countries most favorably disposed toward Israel. During the Cold War, there were, of course, two German states, and both had very different relations with the State of Israel. I'm very pleased tonight that Professor Jeffrey Herf of the University of Maryland at College Park has joined us tonight to explain it all to us. Jeffrey is one of America's most knowledgeable and perhaps also most controversial experts on German-Israeli and American-Israeli relations. He also has worked extensively on German and European history in the 20th century. Jeffrey has published a great deal on Germany during the Weimar Republic, Nazi Germany, the Holocaust, and on West and East Germany during the Cold War. Jeffrey Herf taught at Harvard and Ohio University before joining the University of Maryland as a distinguished university professor. He has held many important fellowships, for example, at Harvard and Chicago, the Institute of Advanced Studies in Princeton, the Rabin Center in Tel Aviv, and the Woodrow Wilson Center in Washington, D.C. Jeffrey is a well-known teacher and public speaker, but he also is a very prolific writer. Among his many books are Nazi Propaganda in the Arab World, The Jewish Enemy, Nazi Propaganda during World War II and the Holocaust, and also, of course, Divided Memory, The Nazi Past in the Two Germanies. Jeffrey has also written a book about Soviet power and the Battle of the Euro Missiles, and a book on reactionary modernism about the use of technology, culture, and politics during the Weimar Republic and the Nazi era. And his latest book, published by Cambridge University Press, came out only a few months ago. It is entitled At War with Israel, East Germany and the West German Far Left, 1967 to 1989. And it goes without saying, you should buy this book. It is a great pleasure, of course, to welcome Jeffrey Herf to UNC tonight. Today, Jeffrey will talk about war and terror against Israel during the Cold War and the post-9/11 world, with a special emphasis on the relations of East Germany with Israel. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Professor Jeffrey Herf.
Begin with some extremely disappointing news. The book that I'm speaking about this evening actually has not yet been published. It will be published in the spring of 2016. So if you try to rush out and buy a copy right now, you'll be very disappointed. But I hope that it will be of some interest. It's an enormous honor for me to be speaking here at the university, at University of North Carolina. Two people who mean a great deal to me as a German historian are on the faculty. Gerhard Weinberg is a mentor, a teacher, a hero to many, many historians of my generation. I can't tell you how much many of us have learned, not only from his scholarship, but from his decency. And Konrad Jarosz is the leading historian of East Germany, and one of the leading historians of 20th century German history in the United States. So this university, in the form of Professors Weinberg and Jarosz, has made huge contributions to the study of German history. And I'm very glad to be here, and I want to thank Professor Laris for the invitation. We were speaking just briefly beforehand about the importance of having an intelligent discussion of America's place in the world, American foreign relations, and so I hope that my comments this evening will contribute to that. I've been told to speak no more than 40 minutes, so I will stick to that request. The book that I have finished and will be coming out in the spring is about the German Democratic Republic, which I'm going to refer to as East Germany, and it also is about organizations in West Germany of the radical left, which you may be more familiar with because they received a great deal of media attention, such as the Baader-Meinhof group or the Red Army faction or the Revolutionary Cells. And I'm not going to speak about them this evening. If you want to ask questions about them in discussion period, I'll be glad to discuss them. But what I've concluded is that, the historians in the room, I think, will not find this surprising, that the amount of media attention devoted to the West German organizations and the relative lack of media attention to the East German government reverses in reality their importance for events in the Middle East. And so one of the major points that I want to make this evening is that the Soviet bloc, of which East Germany was a small but vocal member, was far more important for events in the Middle East than were the much more publicized, spectacular actions of West German terrorist organizations of the left. I also have come to the conclusion, and probably historians of the Cold War have reached similar conclusions, that the battles in the Cold War in the Middle East were of decisive significance for its outcome. I think, for example, the outcome of the wars of 1967 and 73 and 82 were of more importance for the eventual outcome of the Cold War than we were aware of at the time. But as a German historian, the fact that the East German government and West German organizations were, in my view, at war with Israel is of considerable importance. I have written a book about what is the tradition of what is called coming to terms with the past in West Germany. The German term is Vergangenheitsbewältigung. And if I would reduce the West German tradition of how to come to terms with the crimes of the Nazi past against the Jews, but against many others, it would be a kind of 11th commandment of post-war German history. Konrad Jarosz has written very well about Germany's return to civilization and humanity. So maybe it's in that spirit that I would just summarize a very complex tradition by saying that the 11th commandment of post-war German history is do no more harm to the Jews. Don't kill any more Jews. And don't help anyone else to kill or harm or terrorize any more Jews. If you bring some Nazis to trial, if you pay restitution, if you help some ailing survivors of the Holocaust live through their old age without sinking into poverty, well, that would also be very nice. That would be very nice indeed. But at least don't do that. That doesn't seem too much to ask as an 11th commandment of post-war German history, of German history after Nazism. And the book that I'm writing is about people who broke that commandment or didn't feel that it was their commandment or who viewed it as a kind of sentimental and hypocritical set of dictum that was a kind of apologia for what they call German imperialism and neo-fascism. The book that I've finished recently is a sequel to a book that Professor Laris mentioned, Divided Memory, The Nazi Past and the Two Germanies. That is a book in part is about a number of purges that took place in the Soviet bloc in the early 1950s called the anti-cosmopolitan purges, which perhaps some of you are familiar with, in which the wartime empathy and sympathy that was so evident in Andrei Gromyko's speech at the United Nations in 1947 or 48, when he supported the United Nations partition plan and thus implicitly accepted the right of the Jews to a state of their own, that empathy and that sympathy gave way to hostility to Zionism. That turn of the Soviet bloc from empathy to hostility to Israel persisted from really 1949 until 1989. Now, in the last years of the 1980s, we can talk about that. There were some efforts to moderate this policy, but the key point is that the policies that the Soviet bloc pursued were not policies that aimed at the correction of this or that Israeli policy. These were policies which, had they been successful. In my estimation, would have led to the destruction of the State of Israel by force of arms. And one of the things that is perhaps obvious to this audience, but struck me again and again as I work on the book, is that had it not been for the United States, especially from the 1970s on, the State of Israel might not have survived the Cold War. I want to talk a bit off the cuff about the four major events. The Six-Day War of 1967, the emergence of an alliance between the East German government and the Palestine Liberation Organization in the aftermath of the attack on the Munich Olympics in 1972, the Yom Kippur War of 1973, and then some comments about the language of anti-Zionism that accompanied Israel's invasion of Lebanon in 1982. So I'm going to read some details. I am a historian. The details matter, but I'll try not to bore you with details. We are supposed to be concerned about facts, so I apologize. I'm going to give you some facts. On June 7th of 1967, 2 days after the Six-Day War began, the East German Politburo of the Socialist Unity Party. The Socialist Unity Party was the term that really was the name for the Communist Party. Along with officials from the Foreign and Defense Ministry met in East Berlin. And I should add that after 1989-90, all of the archives of the East German government, of the decision-making Politburo, of the decision implementation institutions of the Council of Ministers, of the Defense Ministry, of the Foreign Affairs, and of the Ministry of State Security, the Stasi, all of these archives are available. This again is remarkable. This is the second German dictatorship of the 20th century whose archives are now all available, not subject to a 30-year rule, but all available. So I couldn't have written this book had it not been for the East German Revolution of 1989 and the opening of the archives. So the group met on the 7th of June, and they decided to send weapons to Egypt, led by Gamal Nasser, and the Ba'athist Syria, led by Hafez al-Assad. In question period, I'll be glad to talk about the centrality of Syria for Soviet policy in the Middle East. Syria was the linchpin of the Soviet bloc policy in the Middle East, and in that sense, Mr. Putin's intervention and support for the Assad regime is perfectly in tune and very much a continuation of mentalities and emotions and interests that were there in the Soviet period. I mean, yes, there are differences, of course, but this goes very deep. Syria was the linchpin. By the beginning of April of 1967, before the war, East Germany had sent 20 MiG-17 fighters jets to Egypt. In July, it sent 30 more. In June of 1967 alone, East German deliveries to Egypt included 35 Soviet T-34 tanks, 5,000 Kalashnikov assault weapons with 600,000 bullets of 7.62 millimeter machine guns. I had to learn a lot about weapons, right? In this book, you know, and for a professor who is like not too familiar with weapons, this was an educational experience. Something like another 9,000 machine guns and assault weapons were sent to Egypt in June of 67. Now, in Karl Marx's phrase, the East Germans combined the arm of criticism with the criticism of arms. And the arm of criticism came in the form of Walter Ulbricht, the leader of the country, the leader of the Socialist Unity Party, in a very famous speech that you probably can read in English translation in the university library here, delivered on June 15th of 1967 in Leipzig. To the surprise of many people who had not been following developments in the Soviet bloc and in East Germany carefully over the previous two decades, Mr. Ulbricht denounced Israel and supported the Arab states. He claimed that Israel had faced no military threats before the war, this despite the movement of Arab armies closer to Israel's borders, Nasser's decision to close the Gulf of Aqaba, the Israeli shipping, and verbal threats to drive the Jews into the sea, coming from Arab capitals in the weeks preceding the war. By the way, graduate students, undergraduates, faculty, if you have not used the BBC Summary of World Broadcasts, which are available at the Library of Congress on microfilm, I don't know if you have them in your library here, they are fantastic. And there you can get English translations, not only of Arabic radio and television, newspapers, but the media all over the world. Ulbricht said that the war was in fact part of the global strategy of U.S. imperialism and that Israel was its willing tool. And in this sense, this book is about the secular era of anti-Zionism. It's not about the Islamist era of anti-Zionism. So for the communists, the communists did not revive the classic themes of anti-Semitism in the sense that they did not view Israel as the center of a world conspiracy, or that the Jews were running the world. Rather, Israel was the tool of the main conspirator, which was American imperialism. Toward the end, I'll talk about what I think are some of the similarities and differences between the leftist anti-Zionism of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and what we've seen in recent years. At the United Nations, which is an enormously important institution for understanding what goes on in the Middle East, and the battles that were waged about it. Soviet Ambassador Yakov Malik compared Israel's surprise attack that began the war with the Nazis' war on the Eastern Front in World War II. Ulbricht offered his own comparison of Israel to Nazi Germany, with allusions to the Nazi protectorate in Czechoslovakia and the general government of occupied Poland. He said, quote, "The world could not accept that a quarter of a century after the Second World War, the aggressor Israel and its men behind the scenes form a Sinai protectorate or a general government of Jordan for the purpose of renewed colonial oppression of the Arab peoples." In subsequent decades and up to our own time, the association of Israel with Nazi Germany has remained an enduring element of communist, Arab, Palestinian, and West German and West European and leftist anti-Israeli discourse. It survives down to our own time. In the years following the war, from 1967 to 1970, the Arab states waged what they called a war of attrition. The Israeli ambassador to the United States at the time, Yosef Tekua, in his letters to the Secretary General, which are fascinating and important, and again, graduate students, undergraduates, faculty, the United Nations official document system is online. All of you can read it at home. It takes a little bit of work in the UN yearbook to find things, but Tekoa's reports were very detailed about this and that particular attack. East Germany and the Soviet bloc were delivering weapons to Egypt and to Syria. And again, I don't want your eyes to glaze over, but the deliveries included MiG jets, repairing jet engines. In these 3 years, 17,000 Kalashnikov machine guns, 150,000 landmines, tens of thousands of hand grenades. Word got out in Asia, in Latin America, in Africa, and in the Middle East that the East Germans were not like the West Germans, that the East Germans were proud of their struggle against American imperialism and global capitalism, that they were proud of their support of national liberation movements, armed national liberation movements. Word got out that if you wanted to get training, weapons, money, that East Germany was an address that you should think of. And the East German government was faced with increasing requests from many states and movements for military support. And so it had to formalize a program to address this issue. And the files of the Council of Ministers in Berlin indicate that on September 30th, 1969, Willy Stoff, a member of the Politburo and president of the East German Council of Ministers, assigned the deputy Council of Ministers, Gerhard Weiss, to coordinate delivery of weapons to states around the world, including the Arab states. And Gerhard Weiss remained the center of that program for the next 15 years. It is common to view East Germany in this country as an isolated, lonely, unloved dictatorship that, after all, constructed the Berlin Wall and a border of landmines and machine gun towers in order to imprison its 17 million citizens. And so, from the American or perhaps West European perspective, this regime was thought to be despicable, tyrannical, intrusive, and unloved. Well, that's a rather narrow perspective. Because what happened, beginning in 1969, was that East Germany, in fact, around the world, and especially in the Third World, became quite popular, and in many places, more popular than West Germany. The West German government, those of you who remember Konrad Adenauer and his successors, viewed the East German government as an illegitimate regime, one that was there only because the Soviet Union bayonets was keeping it, and tanks were keeping it in power. And therefore, it inaugurated what came to be known as the Hallstein Doctrine. Very briefly, that meant that West Germany would refuse diplomatic recognition to any government that established diplomatic relations with East Germany. And the Hallstein Doctrine from the 50s up through 1969 persisted and succeeded in isolating East Germany. And so one of the key aims of East German foreign policy was to gain diplomatic recognition from countries outside the Soviet bloc. It had diplomatic recognition with Hungary, Czechoslovakia, the Soviet Union, and Communist China, etc. But to get diplomatic recognition beyond the Soviet bloc and the communist world. On April 30th of 1969, Iraq became the first non-communist government, or rather after Norodom Sihanouk's Cambodia, to establish diplomatic relations with East Germany. The breakthrough, one of the great successes of East German foreign relations, was due to the persistent efforts of Otto Winzer, East Germany's foreign minister from 1965 to 1975. The joint declaration issued by Winzer and Iraqi Foreign Minister Abdul Karim al-Sheikhli on May 10th of 1969, at the conclusion of a week of negotiations in Baghdad, made a clear connection between Iraq's decision to establish diplomatic relations and East Germany's position regarding Israel. The two foreign ministers stressed, quote, their shared struggle against imperialism, neo-Nazism, colonialism, and Zionism, and described Israel as a racist, imperialist, reactionary, and aggressive state. The description of Israel as a racist state, an imperialist spearhead, and even as a state similar to Nazism was thus embedded in the beginnings of diplomatic relations between these two states and also in the political language of the Soviet bloc. Similar language accompanied the establishment of diplomatic relations between East Germany and Sudan on June 3rd, Syria on June 5th, Egypt as well as South Yemen on July 10th in 1969, and an increase in weapons deliveries of MiG fighter jets to Syria and Egypt followed. So the anti-Zionist card, the presentation of East Germany as the good Germans, unlike the bad Germans, the good Germans who fought the Israelis, the good Germans who fought against colonialism and imperialism, was a crucial card to play in breaking the Hallstein Doctrine restrictions and expanding East Germany's relations not only with the Arab states, but then with many other states and movements in Africa and Latin America and in Asia. So I think one of the points I want to make in the book is to revise a bit a certain America-centric and Eurocentric perception of the loneliness and isolation of the East German government. There really was such a thing as international communism. In the 1960s and 1970s. It was more international than the international communism of the 1920s and 1930s, which was a more Eurocentric phenomenon. So the Windsor's success had a great deal to do, both with Marxist-Leninist ideology regarding the attack on international imperialism and capitalism, and on the sympathy for the Arabs and the antagonism to Israel. And it's important to keep in mind that people like Windsor and Ulbricht were not struggling with pangs of conscience. Oh, how can we do this? And this is so terrible. And we're Germans. And how can we? No, there was none of that. It was, we are doing the right thing. Zionism is simply an illegitimate aspect of the global imperialist system against which we are struggling. Another person, an individual, not a household name in the United States, who played a central role in this story is a man named Heinz Hoffmann. He was born in 1910 and died in 1985, and he was East Germany's Minister of Defense from 1960 to 1985. And he was at the center of East Germany's state-to-state relations with the Arab governments. Erich Honecker succeeded Walter Ulbricht as the General Secretary of the Socialist Unity Party and the head of the government, and he, Honecker, and Heinz Hoffmann were crucial to East Germany's alliance with the Arab states. And Heinz Hoffmann's files in the Defense Ministry archives in Freiburg are fascinating. And he kept very good reports about his various trips. And he took a trip in 1971. Let me see if we can make things work here. Yeah, great. You're looking at a photo of the the general staff of the East German military. That's Heinz Hoffmann, and I'm not sure, this might be Admiral Werner, I'm not, I could get the names of the others, but this is the East German general staff, and that's the Syrian general staff. And they're meeting on October 21st, 1971, in Damascus. And the relationship with Hoffmann and Mustafa Talas, who was one of the gentlemen sitting there, Mustafa Talas is a very important figure. Mustafa Talas was the Syrian defense minister from the early 70s, almost until 2000, one of the cornerstones of the Assad regime. So Hoffmann and Talas got to know each other, at least as much as one can glean from the archives. In the course of extolling solidarity in their common struggle against Zionism, Hoffmann observed that Talas clearly expressed a tendency, this is a quote, that existed among other leading officers of the Arab Armed Forces, namely, quote, an unconditional admiration for the fascist blitzkrieg strategy and the expert accomplishments of the bourgeois German military, unquote. Hoffmann was unfazed by Talas's admiration for the Wehrmacht's accomplishments. He expressed confidence that the Syrians, quote, will be victorious against in their battle against the enemy. And we are fighting the same enemy, he said, that is the United States and Israel. The relationship between East Germany and Syria, between Hoffmann and Talas, deepened in the following decade, and Assad Syria, as I said a few moments ago, became the linchpin of Soviet state-to-state policy in the Middle East, just as it is the linchpin of Russian policy in the Middle East today. Many of you will remember, perhaps all of you know, about the attack by the Black September terrorist organization on the Israeli athletes at the Munich Olympics in 1972. In the weeks following the massacre, Hans-Dietrich Genscher, the gentleman in the lower right, West Germany's interior minister at the time, then became West Germany and then Germany's foreign minister, a major, major figure of post-war European and German history. Hans-Dietrich Genscher signed an order banning an organization called the General Union of Palestinian Students. The initials, the General Union Palästinensischen Studenten, the abbreviations GUPS or GUPS. The West German authorities had gathered evidence that GUPS was an arm of the Palestine Liberation Organization, the PLO. And in these years, it's important to remember that the PLO was operating on policies established in its charter of 1968. And I'm not going to go into the 1968 charter of the PLO. It is online. If you Google it, you can read it for yourself, so I won't belabor that. But the bottom line was that the charter of 1968 was a charter that attacked all compromise, peaceful efforts to reach a compromise with Israel, called for armed struggle, armed struggle whose purpose was to eliminate the state of Israel. And the purpose of the GUPS was to open up a front of this struggle in West Germany. One of the Palestinian German language publications at the time was in fact called the Front. During the Munich attack, the Black September terrorists called the GUPS office in Bonn. In the month after the attack, the West German authorities expelled about 300 members of the GUPS. They seized the property of the organization and dissolved and banned it. And the files of the West German Interior Ministry in Koblenz are fascinating, and of the West German Supreme Court, as you know, as many of you know, that investigations in the German legal system are carried out by judges, and some of these investigations are remarkably detailed. According to West German law, organizations whose members or leaders are entirely or partly foreigners can be banned according to the law regarding such associations if, through their political activity, they damage or endanger the inner security and public order of the Federal Republic of Germany. And Genscher and the officials in the Interior Ministry concluded that GUPS fit that description, and the ban order was issued not because the groups opposed Israel, or not because the groups thought Israel was illegitimate, or not because it argued that Israel was racist, imperialist, and the Palestinians were being oppressed. All of that is fine and protected by free speech. No problem. Anybody can say anything they want about how terrible Israel is. The problem for Genscher and for the Interior Ministry was that Goops was using, in their view, West German territory to wage war against, that is, use political violence wage war against Israel. And that, he decided, was not acceptable. The Federal Republic of Germany, West Germany, was not going to be used. Its territory was not going to be used for those purposes. So, of course, the members of groups and those who in West Germany who supported it said, nonsense, this is racism, this is Araberfeindlichkeit, hostility to Arabs per se. The West German decision to ban the groups was a huge opportunity for East Germany, which it seized. The Arab governments were furious with West Germany for banning the groups, and they noted the contrast to East Germany's policy of antagonism toward Israel. And though they publicly condemned the attack on the Olympics, and I have not seen any evidence of East German involvement in the attack on the Israeli athletes. I have not seen any evidence of it. I have other historians have not seen any evidence of it. Many, many files of the late 60s and early 70s were destroyed in the fall of 1989. There's just some things we, as far as I know, maybe somebody else will find out. But it wouldn't have fit well, for reasons I'll explain in a moment, it would not have fit well with East German national interests to have been involved. But after the attack, the Arafat, Yasser Arafat, wrote to General Secretary Honecker about what he called the action in Munich. He said the PLO was not responsible for the actions of Black September, which was in a statement that the CIA, the Bundesnachrichtendienst, the West German Intelligence Service, and the Mossad all thought was a lie. They thought that Black September offered a kind of a fig leaf for Arafat and that he was, in fact, somehow involved, which was very difficult to prove. But he said, we of the executive committee of the PLO approve, treasure, are proud of, and take hope and strength from the sincere friendship for our cause and your sympathy that you have shown us, as well as your recognition of our right and struggle. He urged understanding of the action in Munich from the viewpoint of the general problem and its historical events with all their political and national human dimensions. If one wants really to distinguish between the deep causes and the peripheral and secondary events, it is futile and useless to view the action apart from the stream of events and from their whole historical framework. Men of affairs, women of affairs, but at the time men of affairs, understood, and Honecker certainly understood, that what Yasser Arafat was saying to him was that whether or not he was personally involved or made the decision to engage in the attack on the Olympics, he was offering justifications for it. And Honecker then replied at the end of November with a public, warm, very public, warm reading in which he attacked recent acts of Israeli aggression and expressed his solidarity for the PLO. Arafat first visited East Berlin between October 30th and November 2nd of 1971. This is the cover of a pamphlet that Ulrike Meinhof, a West German leftist, wrote about the attack, in which she celebrated the attack as a great struggle against imperialism. Arafat first visited East Germany, East Berlin, at the invitation of its Afro-Asian Solidarity Committee in 1971. And on several more visits in 1973, he met with Politburo members Hermann Axen and Gerhard Grunberg. And Grunberg became the key contact member, a person with the PLO. But in August of 1973, that is about a year after the Munich attack, the East Germans celebrated Arafat at a major attraction of the World Youth Festival in East Berlin, and it was then that he held the first of many meetings with Honecker. In September of 73, East Germany became the first of the Soviet bloc states to open a PLO consulate in its capital, and it did so a year before the Soviet Union did. The first communist country to open a PLO office was Mao's China in 1965. But East Germany was ahead of the Soviets in this regard. And one of the key points that I want to make this evening in the book has to do with East German passion and enthusiasm. Yes, the government of East Germany was utterly dependent upon the Red Army and the Soviet Union for its survival, as became so evident when Gorbachev made the fateful decision not to use force to protect the regime. But despite that enormous dependence, the East Germans had a certain autonomy, a certain ability within the framework established by the Soviet Union to pursue their policies. And they were not led kicking and screaming against their will into these policies. They did it with enthusiasm and passion. And in 1973, you see here, Arafat is, this is Yasser, obviously Yasser Arafat, that's Gerhard Grunberg. And they are signing an agreement that included East Germany's promise to deliver, quote, solidarity goods in the civilian and non-civilian area, that is, weapons. And similar agreements for civilian and military deliveries were signed on an annual basis for the next 15 years. The decision of September 73 to open a PLO office in East Berlin took place when the PLO was, as I said, basing its actions on the Charter of 1968, when it was engaged in armed struggle with the purpose of destroying the State of Israel. This signing is one of those events that demonstrated the vanguard role and initiative that the East German communists brought to the anti-Israeli cause. Some of you may know the Central Intelligence Agency has declassified, I think now, 12 million documents from the Cold War in the CREST system at the National Archives. If you go up the third floor of the National Archives, you can sit at a computer, and if you can put up with the irritating computer system and type in the proper keywords and finally wind up with something of interest, you can print it out for free. And you will find, as I did, that East Germany contributed about 3%, according to the CIA, 3% of the weapons deliveries to the Middle East and the Third World in this period. If I was Nikita Khrushchev or Mr. Brezhnev, I also would have been incredibly irritated with Mao Zedong, because overwhelmingly the weapons that flew went to the Third World in the 60s and 70s and 80s came from Soviet factories, and the Chinese contributed almost nothing, and what they did contribute didn't work very well. But it was the Soviets who had the reputation as being gray, boring, and counter-revolutionaries, whereas the Chinese were, of course, in the vanguard of the global revolution. This must have caused a lot of heartache in the Kremlin. I see that I have, 10 minutes left. So many fascinating details. The opening of the PLO office, the opening of the PLO office in East Berlin aroused a lot of concern among American diplomats in West Berlin and leaders of the Jewish community in West Berlin, the very small Jewish community, the mayor of West Berlin. And what they were worried about was Berlin-Schönefeld Airport. Because with the opening of the office, what was happening was that young men who were politically active were flying to East Germany from Beirut, from Damascus. And once in East Germany, they were able, without much difficulty, to go to West Germany. And so the issue about the PLO office raised concerns about terrorism that these young people might participate in West Berlin, West Germany, and Western Europe. And it wasn't only the State Department in Washington or the West German government or the Jewish community in West Berlin that was concerned about this. The Stasi was worried about it as well. The Ministry of State Security was worried about it as well. And the Stasi was keeping very close touch keeping very close eye, rather, on Palestinian organizations, which included Al-Fatah, the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, Al-Saika, the Democratic Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, And there were Stasi memos about these people, which of course they supported, and they were agreed with their anti-imperialist struggle and expressed solidarity with their fundamental views. But they were very worried that these people would get out of hand and start blowing things up and killing people in West Germany and in Western Europe. This issue, it was one of our diplomats in West Berlin named David Klein, and here the State Department files are very interesting, was sending increasingly concerned memos back to Washington, and they rose to the level of Secretary of State Henry Kissinger. And Kissinger then decided that a memo needed to be sent to the Soviets saying, as members of what was called the Four Power Arrangement, the Soviets shared responsibility with the United States, Britain, and France for preserving law and order in West Berlin. And that if things started blowing up and people were being killed in terrorist activities, that he would hold the Soviet Union responsible, which was important because if this were to affect American-Soviet relations, then that could undermine detente, that could undermine arms control agreements, undermine trust. And so the Soviets conveyed the message to the East Germans that you must do something to somehow square a circle. And squaring the circle was, how do you articulate anti-imperialist solidarity and support for national liberation struggles around the world, but not permit them to engage in terrorist acts in Western Europe? And that is the origin of what I am calling East Germany's Eurocentric definition of counterterrorism. East Germany's Eurocentric definition of counterterrorism. By 1979, the director of the Stasi, Erich Mielke, and the deputy director of the Terrorabwehr, the counterterrorism division of the Stasi, Gerhard Niebuhr, had time to think this through. And on May 8th of 1979, they circulated a memo with the following title. It's a long title. And this is a direct translation. Information about activities of representatives of the Palestine Liberation Movement in association with international terrorists seeking to include the German Democratic Republic in the preparation of acts of violence in the country of Western Europe. That's the Stasi memo, right? But by the way, one of the refreshing things about the Stasi memos and the, is that when they are talking about terrorists, they use the term terrorists, which was not the case of the East German diplomats of the United Nations. Groups within the Palestine Liberation Movement in association with anarcho-terrorist groups have intensified their efforts to use the territory of the GDR as a logistical base and starting point for the implementation of acts of violence in Western Europe. The GDR's generous stance of solidarity toward the National Liberation Movement of the Arab peoples is seen by these groups as offering favorable conditions for the planning and implementation of its operations. The communication possibilities of the GDR's capital city, East Berlin, are also taken into account, in particular after the separate peace, that is the Camp David Accord, went into effect. The PLO activated the planning and preparation of acts of violence seen as acts of war against Western countries. Such activities that are based in the territory of the GDR, let me repeat this, such activities that are based in the territory of the GDR create political dangers and damage to our national security interests. According to our internal information, influential forces within the Palestine Liberation Movement are strengthening their efforts, especially against Israel, and Egyptian persons and objects are preparing terrorist acts and acts of violence and are operating in part from the territory of the socialist country. Details, I'm going to have to summarize. How do you implement this policy? How do you support terrorist attacks on Israel carried out by the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine or the various members of the Executive Committee of the PLO? How do you train these people? How do you send them to universities in East Germany? How do you give them fellowships? How do you give them medical care after they're wounded in East German hospitals? How do you send them weapons? How do you send them money? How do you do all this, and the Hungarians and the Czechs and the Soviets as well, without them getting the idea that they're involved in an international struggle against imperialism and capitalism, which has to be brought home to the countries of Europe? Well, the way you square that circle, The way that you encourage terrorism in one part of the world and prevent it in another is to establish close relations with an organization that knows where the terrorists are. And that happened in formal agreements between the East German Ministry of State Security, the Stasi, and the intelligence services of the Palestine Liberation Organization, led by a man named, with the nom de guerre Abu Ayad, in 1979 and 1980. And the purpose of the intelligence cooperation of these two intelligence services was to facilitate the purposes of the national liberation struggles around the world and in the Middle East, that is the war against Israel, but to also convey the message to Carlos and to George Habash and to whoever else may have had the idea that they were not to blow things up and not to carry out terrorist acts in West Germany and Western Europe, because that would undermine detente, that would damage Soviet bloc foreign policy in Europe, and this was not to be permitted. And so the world is complicated, and the world of intelligence is particularly complicated, and I find this, the Eurocentric definition of counterterrorism, one of the most interesting aspects of the book. Was East Germany a state sponsor of terrorism? You bet. Was the Soviet Union? Yes. But not against Western Europe. When Abu Ayad had conversations with Erich Mielke and Gerhard Niebuhr in East Berlin, these conversations are also marvelously refreshing. Because when they speak to one another about terrorism, they use the word terrorism, and they dispense with the euphemisms that, you know, the West, that in the West people would, oh, one man's freedom fighter is another man's terrorist. No, a terrorist, you blow things up in a cafe, you kill the people who are drinking the cappuccino, that's terrorism, right? And that's the way they talk to one another. They knew exactly what they were supporting. How much more time do I have? A few minutes. I'm going to really summarize, because the Yom Kippur War is fascinating when one compares the policies pursued by Richard Nixon, who got very few votes from Jews in the United States, and as you know, sometimes made comments about Jews that were not so pleasant. And the policies pursued by Willy Brandt, who won the Nobel Peace Prize after he kneeled it down at the memorial to the Jews murdered at the Warsaw Ghetto, and was known as a man, not a man of peace, but a man of reconciliation, a man who irritated his fellow Germans because he insisted that they look at the truth of the Nazi past. The official position of the West German government during the Yom Kippur War, when the survival of Israel, for reasons I'll explain in a moment, was up in the air, in the balance, the official position of the West German government was one of neutrality. The United States, what the Israelis learned in October of 1973 was that in the event of war, Israel had one ally that had not only the inclination, but also the means to come to its assistance in extremis. And that was the United States. I don't have time to go into Operation Nickel Grass in any great detail, but Operation Nickel Grass was the resupply operation that Nixon ordered in order that the Soviets not win a victory in the Middle East and that Israel not be defeated. And Operation Nickel Grass involved American planes flying hopefully to Europe, but the Europeans said, no, you can't land here because we don't want to offend the Arabs, and the Arabs now have the oil weapon to pressure us. The exchanges between American diplomats and West German diplomats in the last 2 weeks of October are increasingly testy and bitter because the West Germans are insisting that there are two Israeli ships that are trying to bring weapons from American bases in Germany at the port of Bremerhaven, and the West German diplomats are insisting those Israeli ships are not coming into Bremerhaven, because if the Israeli ships come into Bremerhaven, it's going to be obvious to everybody in the world where they're going. We are not in this war. Those Israeli ships have to leave Bremerhaven immediately. Get out! We don't want them here. It got very testy. And then said, well, all right, if the American ships want to come and you want to bring some of your ammunition, then people can, you know, who knows where American ships are going. At the same time, and these were very, very testy. The Western Alliance was really fractured in 1973 to a greater degree than many of us realized. Kissinger was furious. He referred to the European capitulation to the Arabs. Now, at the same time that this was taking place, I'll go through some of these photos when I finish. At the same time that this was taking place in the Western Alliance, East Germany was involved in sending a squadron of MiG jet fighters to Syria. This is a plaque in on one of the air bases of East Germany. In the fall of 1973, the members of JG8 fulfilled their duties with the Soviet class and brothers in weapons in Aleppo, a city in North Syria. They fulfilled their international duty, and enforced the Israeli aggressor to in so doing they contributed to force the Israeli aggressor to stop the war against the Arab peoples. So they were very proud of that endeavor. This is a map, a very large map, that the East German Defense Ministry drew about the voyage of the Freiburg and the Klosterfeld, two East German freighters who departed from Rostock in mid-October and arrived in the Syrian port of Tartus in November, carrying about 2,200 tons of military equipment, including 62 Soviet T-54 tanks, 300 anti-tank rifles, 24,000 shells, 75,000 grenades. Now, 2,200 tons of equipment was a fraction of the 70 to 100,000 tons that the Soviet Union and the United States were each sending to the region during the war, but it was very important to Eric Honecker, who received notices about this every morning for several weeks. I'm going to conclude with a few comments now. Leaving out a lot. The historians in the room know how I'm struggling. antagonism to Israel became the norm among communist regimes and the radical left around the world in these years. But there's an obvious difference between East Germany and other anti-Israeli states. Nowhere outside of Germany could antagonism to Israel bring the apparent benefits of liberation from the benefit of the Nazi past. In redefining Israel as the aggressor, as a contemporary version of fascism and Nazism, the communists and the radical left enveloped hatred of Israel in the aura of leftist anti-fascism. And that gave it a global and international respectability, which it has retained up to our own time. The last paragraph. The events I've discussed this evening took place in the secular era of anti-Zionism. It stands in contrast to the Islamist anti-Zionism of the Iranian regime and of the Sunni Islamists in the Muslim Brotherhood, Hamas, and Hezbollah. This theologically based anti-Zionism of our own time wears its hatred of the Jews proudly and publicly. As the Hamas Charter of 1988 made perfectly clear, the Islamists do not obscure the links to classical anti-Semitism. The secular era of German leftist anti-Semitism, which I have examined this evening, made valuable contributions to the demonization of the State of Israel by making it respectable in the traditions of the global left. It spread many falsehoods about Israel, but falsehoods which carried more legitimacy around the world precisely because they came from those who declared themselves to be anti-fascists and opponents of racism. No wonder that these antagonists of Israel called the idea that they were anti-Semites an old Zionist trick. The trick was actually another one. It was to offer a cloak for others who were helping to kill and wound Israelis in the mantle of anti-fascism, and to insist that doing so had absolutely nothing at all to do with anti-Semitism. So,
thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Jeffrey. That was a most enlightening talk, also rather long, but we enjoyed it. Let me ask you, if relations with the between the GDR and the Arab countries were so close in terms of anti-Israeli sentiment, what about the 1980s when the GDR itself got into deep trouble financially, had to go to the West Germans and to other countries to obtain loans? Did they go to the Arab countries as well to ask for some help now?
There were two kinds of weapons deliveries. One were called Solidaritätsgüter, that is weapons delivered without cost. In the 1980s, the delivery of weapons to make money became more and more important. So I don't go into the details of finance in East Germany. Trying to figure out East German finances is really quite a task. So there was that. In the late 80s, East Germany wanted better relations with the United States, and thought somehow that dealing with Jewish organizations would help it do that, which was a peculiar thing. I'm glad you asked the question because it's a point that I didn't make but is very important. And that is that the collapse of the East German government and the collapse of the Soviet bloc in 1989 was a devastating blow to the Palestine Liberation Organization. In the August of 89, one of the members of the East German Politburo went to Tunis and met with leaders of the PLO, and they were expressing grave worry about the events in Prague and in Poland and East Germany, because they understood very well that if the Soviet bloc were to change its policies, that they would be losing their financier, their weapons deliveries, they would be losing a great deal. So I think that one of the consequences of 1989 in Europe was Arafat's decision to enter into the Oslo negotiations.
Thanks very much. Let's open it to questions. Yes, Karen.
First of all, thank you for that really interesting talk.
Speak up, please?
Sure. Thank you for your really interesting talk.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask you about comparisons between East Germany and other countries in the communist bloc.
Yes.
Because what really struck me, and I'm going to ask sort of a three-part question that are really, really the same.
You a Washington journalist?
Yeah. What's that?
Are you a Washington journalist?
I used to be.
Three-part question.
Nobody longer. What struck me was that your starting point was the speech in 1967, right? The Oktober speech condemning Israel.
Yes.
And my starting point, I read about Poland, is that Lomuka, the Polish premier's speech in 1967.
Uh-huh.
Which says, we don't want a fifth column in this country.
Yes.
And I was struck by the difference in what happened in East Germany and what happened in the subsequent path in East Germany versus Poland, where in Poland, it began an anti-Zionist campaign, which accelerated the following year, but Jews were fired from jobs, and students were kicked out of universities eventually.
Yes.
So when you talk about East Germany, the impact, you talked about both West and East Germany being concerned about protecting Jews from violence within East and West Germany. Was there non-violent impact? Was there any propaganda that identified Jews, all Jews as Zionists, sort of a code word, like you said at the end?
The question is a really important one. In Poland, there was an anti-Zionist campaign in 1967-68, which led to, I don't know the numbers.
13,000.
Many people lost their jobs and emigrated, and by 1967, the Jewish community in East Germany was very, very small. The government never engaged in open attacks on the Jews as such. The key blow in East Germany was in 1952-53, or 49-53. And given the open border with West Germany up to 1961, most of the people who were going to be active in protest had left. Albert Norden, who was a member of the Politburo, did ask prominent Jews to sign a statement denouncing Israeli aggression. And a number of people did, and a number of people didn't. And the people, as far as I know, the people who did not do so they were not jailed. This is a story, you know, when we were, I don't know about you, but when I was in high school, one of the cliches was, it's not what you mean, it's not what you say that's important, it's what you mean, or maybe the opposite. I mean, there's a great deal of debate about whether East Germany an anti-Semitic government or not. It's a good question, and one can get into lots of arguments about definitions and all that. What I'm concerned about is what they did. And I come back to that argument about an 11th commandment. Forget the mood music, but if you're shipping machine guns to the PLO and landmines and RPGs, you know, we know what they're going to be using it for. Doesn't this trouble you? There is a lot of work to be done about the rest of the Soviet bloc and the policies in the Middle East. And when I think about the Yom Kippur War, and I think about the discussions that Nixon and Kissinger were having, the battles in the Middle East seem to me the most important battle of the Cold War was in Europe. But I think the second most important was in the Middle East. And maybe that is, it's just something that is, given that I've just been working on it, what I'm thinking about, but I think there's something to it.
I think you're quite right, particularly after the early to mid-1970s when the Cold War in Europe was stabilizing. Thank you. Any more questions? Yes, please.
Explore the possibility that the East Germans saw Israel as taking sides with the democracies of the U.S. and so that they really had no choice but to join forces with the other enemies of the U.S. imperialistic policies as evidenced by the support of Israel. So I mean, this is a question, was it something to do with whose team you're on?
Absolutely, of course. And this is an important chapter of the global Cold War. I wouldn't diminish that for a moment. The driving force of policy was in Moscow. East Germany was not the driving force of Soviet policy, Soviet bloc policy, of course not. When you look at the debates in the United Nations, the extent to which the Palestine issue, Middle East, was presented on the front pages of the national newspaper, Neues Deutschland, the East Germans didn't take a reserved position. They didn't say, yes, we're part of the Soviet bloc and we will do our duty. They were out front. At least that's how I read the documents. I thought they were very enthusiastic and passionate about it. Even more so publicly, I think, than the Poles or the Hungarians or the Czechs, who may even have been sending more weapons. But the I've not seen any suggestion after 1953 that the East Germans would have said to the Soviets, really, we should return to Gromyko's position of 1947. You know, that was the right thing. Why don't we do that? That was not their view. That moment of October 73, when you reread the documents and recapture that moment, is really one of the fundamental, one of the important moments in the entire history of the Cold War. Because if Nixon, it's ironic, it's really ironic. The Watergate scandal was gathering steam, and here he made this decision. Now you could say, if Nixon, you know, the unsentimental, you know, oh, I did it because of the Soviets, well, you know, whatever. Had he not made that decision, who knows what would have happened. So it's the United States was absolutely indispensable at that moment.
But isn't the question whether the East German regime really was, let's say, ideologically anti-Israel, or whether it was just being useful to be anti-Israel because it appealed to the developing world? It made the East German, otherwise isolated, much more popular as than otherwise, as you rightly said.
Life is complicated. I, you know, my left brain is my right. I mean, how can you separate these two things? You know, it's yes, it was in their self-interest. Yes, they were expanding their popularity. Yes, they were gaining many friends. Yes, in the, I mean, look at the United Nations votes. They're very interesting because there would be, you know, countless resolutions denouncing Israel, 100-5, 98-7, 105-2. And East Germany was always in the middle of this huge 100. And there would be the United States and Israel and maybe Canada, you know, Germany sometimes, or Germany would abstain sometimes, West Germany. So, yes, of course it was in their self-interest, but it was also it was a Herzenssache. I mean, they really, really despised Zionism.
Thank you. Scott.
Yeah, well, thanks a lot for mapping out sort of like the extent of the relationship between the GDR and the PLO. And I was wondering whether you could talk a little bit more about sort of like the dynamic behind that, because we're talking about something like two decades, right? And I was wondering the way, whether, you know, like you made it sound like there's this implicitly, the GDR feels that this would be a great bargaining chip, you know, like establishing official relations with the PLO. Supplying them, and after that developed some kind of hesitations once the Stasi really goes through what that all entails or so, and then establishes hard fast guidelines. So is there some kind of reluctancy creeping up within the GDR during the 1980s?
No.
Okay.
No. I've not seen it. There's frustration. I didn't talk about Israel's invasion of Lebanon. And the invasion of Lebanon is remembered frequently for the massacre in Shatila and Shatila, or it's remembered for the protests that it aroused within Israel. The other aspect of the invasion of Lebanon was that as of the end of that invasion, the PLO no longer had a military option against Israel. And I view the outcome of that war as a significant defeat for Soviet bloc policy in the Middle East. There was the presence of a small army now in southern Lebanon was over. The East Germans remained loyal friends to the PLO. They didn't. They proved to be loyal friends. Just because the PLO had been defeated, forced to, out of Beirut, now they were in Tunis, they didn't abandon them. But there was a certain, I think, frustration and a certain, I also have not seen efforts on the part of East Germany to moderate the PLO. I've not seen them. I've not seen documents either publicly in the UN or in the foreign ministry files to say, "Look, we're giving you weapons. We're helping you out, but you just got to face reality. You know, you're not going to destroy Israel. Just do a deal, okay? It's terrible what happened to you. You know, well, we understand it, but you got to do a deal." No, I haven't seen that.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Go ahead.
You mentioned the resupply in 73 for Israel from the United States by planes.
Yes.
Did the East Germans do anything similar for the other side in the 73 war?
Yeah, maybe I wasn't clear enough. They flew a squadron of MiG jets from East Germany to Aleppo in Syria. These are jets from their own air force. They flew them to Aleppo, and then the planes were flown in the 1982 war by Soviet pilots. So they did that, and then they sent two freighters that I described. Was there something else you had in mind?
No. You mentioned them being used in the 82 war. Was there any direct in the 73
war? Yeah, these events were in the 73 war. I misspoke. They were in the 73 war. And so in the 73 war, what you have is a Western alliance that is at odds with, really, the tensions between the United States and Western Europe were quite intense in the midst of that war. But the Warsaw Pact was unified in its support for the Arab states. And I repeat again, the Israelis at that point understood that while West Germany would certainly be sympathetic and it would have cultural and economic exchanges with Israel and even offer military assistance when in the event of war, Israel had one ally. That became very clear in October of 1970.
Thank you. I know you are a historian. Let's recently briefly talk about more recent events. You said in the 60s, 70s, Israel had one ally, the United States. At the moment, Israeli-American relations are difficult. You wouldn't necessarily repeat that regarding the current times. What has happened? What is happening? Can you give us an explanation?
I can't give a short explanation.
Try, please.
I've written a number of articles for the American Interest magazine. You can see they're online, and you can see some of the things I think. At bottom, it's not a difference between left and right. What it is a difference about how one interprets the beliefs of the leaders of the Iranian government. And I'm a historian of modern Germany, and one of the themes that is, for me, one of the core themes of 20th century German history is that too many people didn't take the Nazis seriously enough. So I haven't spent my career trying to understand why Nazism came to power, or how it did the things it did. I haven't spent my career doing that now in 2015 to say that the Iranian government is a normal government. I don't think it's a normal government. I'm very pessimistic. Let me finish. I'm very pessimistic, and I fear the worst. And that's not because I'm a conservative or a liberal. It's because I have a different view of the interpretation of the goals of the Iranian government. I think it wants to destroy the state of Israel. And so if you take that position, which I feel very deeply, then the problem is that the President of the United States thinks that he's smarter than he is. And he doesn't understand what the Iranian government is about. And he thinks that a different policy towards them will lead them to change their policies. I think that's fundamentally mistaken. I think it's an enormous mistake. And it's not because it has anything to do with right and left. It's a matter of how you interpret the relationship between ideas and politics. And so whether it's the cruder Mr. Ahmadinejad, or the slightly more subtle Mr. Khamenei, or the Mr. Smooth Zarif, I have no doubt that what they really want to do is destroy the state of Israel, and what starts with the Jews does not end with the Jews. This is not just about Israel. This is not just about Israel. So I think that we are in very dangerous waters. I think the Iran deal is a disaster. That I doubt this deal can be enforced. I hope I am wrong. I hope I'm wrong about all of this. But I, at my age, and having written a lot about German history, I'm not going to, you know, reemerge as an optimist about the future. So that is a, you know, it's that is the core reason why there's why there is such a split and a difference between the Obama administration and not just Benjamin Netanyahu, but also Chaim Herzog and the whole Israeli spectrum, except the far left of the Israeli spectrum.
Thank you. I mean, saying that the Iranian regime is of a special nature, let's put it that way, I think is uncontentious. But to compare them directly with the Nazis, that they are like the Nazi regime.
No, I didn't say they're like the Nazis. What I said is, no, I don't think they're like the Nazis. But I do think there's been a failure of comparative historical imagination in the academy. I do think there's been a failure of comparative historical imagination. Not everybody has to have a mustache, have black hair, speak German in order to be dangerous. And the Iranians have deep convictions, which are very important to them. And they are acting on that. So I'm not an enthusiast about the settlement policies. I'm not an enthusiast about various aspects of the Netanyahu government. But I admit, it's my professional defamation. It is my professional defamation. I've spent 35 years of my life trying to understand why this happened in Europe. And I am not, at this point in my life, going to say, oh, it could, you know, nothing like that could ever happen again. But I don't think that's true. And I think too many people in Washington, don't pay enough attention to the different ideas that people in different countries bring to the table. So that's my view. I hope I'm very wrong. I hope I'm proven wrong. But having read the details of the Iran agreement, I don't think it's an agreement that's going to be enforced.
Okay, but apart from the Iranian deal, which, as you rightly said, is of course highly contentious between Israel and America, there are also lots of other issues. You mentioned the settlement issue, for example. So why would Israel not be trying to be more accommodating to its major ally?
You know, I live in an integrated neighborhood in Silver Spring. Probably a lot of you here do as well. And when people go on and on about the settlements, I ask myself, what's so terrible about living with Jewish neighbors? What is really so horrible? So they have a house on a hill. There's another hill. The whole business about the settlements and the focus on the settlements obscures an issue. Do the Palestinians want a state that doesn't have any room for Jews? Is that really what they want? Because that's racist. That amounts to the ethnic cleansing of part of, of the area. Why not just say, if you're willing to live in a Palestinian state, then we will guarantee your rights as citizens, but you will live in a Palestinian state. You won't live in a Jewish state. Now, there are a lot of settlers that will be furious about that, because this is Judea and Samaria, and Abraham was here, and this is our land, and all that. No. If that's your view, there's never going to be peace. But the focus on the settlements, to me, raises that issue. Why not have a Jewish minority in a Palestinian state? What's wrong with that? There's an Arab minority in the Jewish state, isn't that? And that works out sort of. Could be a lot worse. So, to me, the focus on the settlements is a pretext for the Palestinian leadership not wanting to do the final deal and admit that they're not going to go back to Haifa and Tel Aviv, and they're going to have a Palestinian state on the West Bank in Gaza, and that's going to be it. So, that's my view.
Fair enough. Let's have this gentleman left.
But just two points. One, I think the point you're making goes back to your high school phrase. What you're saying is that people mean what they say when they say these things.
You got it.
And Hitler meant what he said, and you're saying the Iranians mean what they say. And if you go back and look at the earliest documents of bin Laden and Zawahiri, they meant what they said. They continue to mean what they said. So I think that, and then more to that, I worked in Washington for 25 years, a lot of time overseas, including the Middle East. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. People in Washington don't understand that other people have a different view of things. They just do not get it, and it's an extraordinary thing to find yourself in the world's capital, and yet it's so parochial. That's just one point. Second point I'd like to make.
I couldn't say it better.
The second point I'd like to make is that I was in Washington during the invasion of Lebanon, and Moshe Aarons was the ambassador, Israeli ambassador to U.S. at the time. He became the Minister of Defense. Mm-hmm. And he was sent on a mission to come around Washington and talk to some principals to defend what was happening. And Reagan, of course, was president. And I participated in one of these meetings, and he just got nowhere. He got nowhere. That was the Lebanon experience may have had the tremendous strategic value that you point out, but it seems to me that that was the beginning of the long slide and deterioration in relations between the United States and Israel to today.
Well, that could be. It's very interesting, to hear your description of that meeting. The one of the things that the United Nations documents that I found so helpful was to read the reports of Yehuda Blum and Chaim Herzog in the late 70s and early 80s. About the terrorist attacks that were coming from southern Lebanon against the cities and towns of northern Israel. And there are hundreds of these letters that are remarkable in their detail. On October 12th of 1980 at 3 in the morning, so-and-so many Kadushas landed in Kiryat Shemona. I mean, the detail is just astonishing. Hundreds of these letters. And the and so that was the dilemma that the Israelis found themselves in. Their life was really becoming unbearable in northern Israel, and I think that the Reagan's relations with the Israelis seemed on the whole pretty good. The world public opinion was aflame when Israel invaded Lebanon. And it wasn't just the communist press that was describing the Israelis as fascists and mass murderers and waging wars of extermination. That was in the Western press as well. So Reagan, I didn't look into that aspect in the book, was relatively supportive of the Israelis and understood the dilemma that they were facing. I don't think the United States pushed Israel into policies that it didn't want to pursue in the 80s. Again, historians of American foreign relations need to examine this. I think what I'm saying is that the destruction of the what I'm saying is the destruction of the PLO arsenal in 1982 was a significant blow to Soviet policy in the Middle East. And I'll bet that as people read the documents of the Reagan administration, that there are people in the Reagan administration who understood that as well. I'm just surmising, that Reagan and Secretary Shultz and others viewed Israel as a strategic ally and an asset more than a pain and a burden. I would just second the first part of your comment. I think that it's important actually for the training of graduate students. Of course, we historians, in our provincial way, think that you need to learn the languages of the countries that you're writing about. That sort of is helpful. You can't write German history if you don't read German. But it seems possible to get a PhD in international affairs and political science in this country without knowledge of foreign languages.
It's impossible.
Yeah, which I think is astonishing.
Thank you.
Thank you. There's a question over there.
Yeah. No? Yeah. Oh yeah, I want to ask a question about your comments about the Israeli-Palestinian modern conflict. So this gentleman, I think, was.
I have opinions more than expertise.
Right. Sorry. Okay. This gentleman was kind of taking out your comments about taking leaders for what they say and. Yeah. Believing their statements, and Netanyahu recently said it's a problem that Arab Israeli citizens are going to be voting in Israeli elections, and also that he doesn't believe in the creation of a Palestinian state. So, as an American citizen, are we supposed to take those words to heart, or are we supposed to think of those as merely political posturing? Or, I mean, what are your thoughts with this?
It wasn't the most politic thing for Netanyahu to say, and I don't agree with him. But I think the problem reread his speech at Bar Ilan University in 2008 or 2009. The next day. The New York Times editorialized that he hadn't said anything new. Now, there are not many American politicians that have the same courage that Netanyahu showed in 2009, because he broke with his base. He broke with his base. They were furious with him. And then he said, I'm supporting a two-state solution. That broke with the whole tradition of the Likud party. And people say, so I think he meant it then. We're in the midst of what we hope will not be a third intifada. There have been murders of Israeli citizens in the last week and a half that go underreported in the Western press. Mr. Abbas has not been especially helpful. So you need a partner. Now, I have a lot of Israeli friends who are furious with Netanyahu and think he's the problem. He's just a disaster. And I'm not Israeli. Maybe they're right, but I. You know, you asked, I think the fundamental problem is that the Palestinians have not made the basic decision that that they're not going to get the whole thing. And they just have to settle for it, and they have to compromise.
Thank you.
I think that's the basic problem.
Lady over there.
I have a question, since we brought up the Iranian nuclear deal.
Yeah.
What would you think would be a solution if what we're doing now is a
solution? I think that Senator Menendez was right. He's been right. He's been the most well-informed and intelligent participant in the Iran debate in the last 10 years. So I would suggest you look at the speeches that he's given. I think that when he says that the Iranians have a decision to make, the Europeans have a decision to make, would they rather do business with Iran or with the United States? I think that is important, that there's a more economic leverage that could have been exercised. To get a better deal. I read the deal closely. I think the built into the deal are structures of economic interest that will make it very difficult to enforce in the event of violations. I think that there was a possibility of using the economic leverage more forcefully.
Thank you. Gentlemen here.
Thanks, Jeffrey.
Yeah.
I just want to get away from current events back to history for a second.
Thank you.
So
I enjoy current events.
I want to ask a question about methodology.
Yes. Yeah.
You've been talking a lot about training graduate students.
Yeah.
And I think it's important to think about this kind of method that you're using, because you've, again and again in your work, I think you've been fairly consistent about this, you've tried to show that ideology precedes action, that ideas trump realpolitik in many ways. I mean, this is the thesis of your.
There's a convergence of the two in this.
Well, there's a convergence. This is the thesis of your talk today, but it's also the thesis of your other books. So I wonder if you see a danger in coming to historical research with the assumption, which I think is a, you know, maybe well informed by this point in your career, but it's still a psychological assumption or a political philosophical thesis, that ideas precede or they drive history, ideology drives. That's been your answer to Klaus Lauer's question, I think, showed that. Is there a danger there in missing something when you come to your research with that kind of assumption? And I wonder, I mean, I pose the question even more sharply. Can you cite examples in history, major examples, where it's not the case, where realpolitik does trump ideology, in German history specifically?
Thank you.
I can't think of many examples in which there's not some mixture of ideas and traditional power politics. And I think that was the point of what I was talking about this evening regarding East Germany's policy in the Middle East. It wasn't only a result of Marxism-Leninism, but it also was part of a kind of traditional national interest. The structure of the Western Alliance or Adenauer's decision to join the Western Alliance was a matter of kind of conventional defense of the country. But if Adenauer were here and you asked him, he would not see it as separate from his own views about Christianity or about democratic institutions. I'm not talking to your question. I think that what I would say is this, that when I was younger, when I entered the profession, there were a lot of people who spent a lot of time arguing about whether people were motivated primarily by ideas or economic interests or political interests. And I think one of the most wonderful developments that I've seen over the last 30 years is that the civil war, the intellectual civil war among us German historians has been pushed to the side. And I may be misreading the situation, but if I think of the work of someone like Ian Kershaw or Chris Browning, that many of you know, or my own work, we don't divide the world as much as we used to when we were younger into those who are motivated by ideas and those who are motivated by traditional political interests or economic interests. At least I think that's one of the welcome developments. If East Germany was only motivated by national interest and traditionally understood, I think that what I saw in the documents would be difficult to account for, namely this passion and enthusiasm. I'm a much more archival historian than I was when I began my career. I find it much more interesting than when I was younger to spend time dealing with thousands and thousands of documents.
Usually it's the other way around.
That's because many people are lazy. And this gentleman here is a hero to many of us because he's not like that. But many people in the academy, they get reviews in the New York Times Sunday edition because they write big synthetic books that demonstrate what a genius they are. And to write a big synthetic book, you go from one side of your study to the other, and you quote a lot of other books that have already been published. It's a hassle to do archival work. You've got to travel, be away from the family, etc. But I would not to give a short final answer to your question, I don't view the Holocaust as the norm. And situations in extremis like that are not the norm. There are many, many examples in which states are operating for mundane economic and political interests. Let me conclude with just a little story. In 1978-9, I was doing my dissertation research in Frankfurt, Mind. And some of the people I became friends with knew the guy who was in Entebbe who was pointing machine guns at Jews, okay? They knew him. And I said, you know, from then I was, you know, how did this happen? How did a guy who grew up in West Germany wind up in Entebbe with Idi Amin pointing machine guns at Jews? What are Germans doing? Why are they doing that? And that question, you know, what are the East Germans doing, being so enthusiastic about these groups that are trying to destroy the state of Israel? I thought that was a puzzle that was worth examining. And that's why I wrote this book, to try and address that puzzle. And I decided, you know, I didn't want to write it 20 years ago or 10 years ago. Or, you know, it took some time to get some distance. But so I'm not generalizing about why all leaders do things. But that puzzle is one that's preoccupied me for many years, and that's why I decided to write this book.
Thank you very much indeed. We have time for one or two more questions, and then we have to go. If there are no questions, let me ask a final question. Again, looking at the Middle East of today, you said before the talk, it's an absolute mess. It's an intransigent situation, highly dangerous. If you were in the White House, what would you recommend doing?
Read Bret Stephens. Stop retreating. Realize that there's a Russian-Syrian Iranian axis that is winning, that this is bad for the United States, that the Middle East remains important for the well-being of the United States and Europe, and there is no other country other than the United States that can establish some kind of order. Everybody is more sober than they were before the war in Iraq, but retreat and abandoning and doing deals with Assad is not gonna produce anything good. These are my political opinions. And you all have views about that. You read the papers. Obviously, a very sophisticated audience. So I don't want to belabor you with my opinions, really, because that's what they are. Some of you read the same newspapers I do, and you probably have some of the same opinions, and some of you don't. If you want specifics, I think General Petraeus was absolutely right. I think we should establish a zone in Syria in which the Syrian opposition will be protected now from the Russians as well as from the Syrians, and when I landed in Berlin in the summer, my taxi driver, I had made the mistake of talking to the taxi driver. So he turned out to be an interesting young Muslim guy who had been in London for 10 years. And so he said, what do you think about Syria? And I said, well, what do you think about Syria? He said, Bashar, nobody does anything about Bashar. Bashar just kills people, nobody does anything about Bashar. I said, yeah, you're right. 220,000 dead Syrians.
Yeah.
One of the things that I've learned as a historian, or just as somebody who pays attention, is that if you're killed by the wrong person, nobody cares. You have to be killed by the right person for people to pay attention. And all these Syrians have been killed by the wrong person, by their own government. If 220,000 Syrians had been killed by Israel, the United Nations would have invaded Israel by now. It'd be over. So, in the name of anti-racism, and in the name of peace, and in the name of all good things, the United States has stood by while this enormous slaughter has taken place. You don't think that there are now thousands and thousands of Syrians that are enraged at the United States because it didn't intervene? What whirlwind have we reaped through this inaction? But look, the world is complicated, but I see the future in somewhat grim terms, and only the United States has the capacity to put the world somewhat back in order.
Thanks, Jeffrey. I would like to point out that in 2 weeks' time we will have a talk here on Iranian-American relations, including the nuclear deal with Iran. We may hear a very different opinion, or maybe a similar opinion. Who knows? But thank you very much for coming and talking to us.